10 minutes, which is very contrary to my nature. John and I have been great friends for a long, long time. With one correction in the introduction, my church is not a post, it is the Union Beans. I was going to give a talk tonight on Greek revival poverty in the 18th century. And we will take it through that. These circumstances made me think maybe I should shift the topic somewhat. We live in a media culture, a little day, this is a calamity. People running up Lower Broadway, Fifth Avenue, Second Tower was falling, leaving their shoes behind, screaming, running. And this is the thought. I was running the other way, again, contrary to my nature, but I had to. And one woman, puffing and puffing, she wasn't a very young woman, puffing and puffing of her life, she thought, turned around suddenly and saw me. She said, "Father Rutler, I love you on TV." And this reminded me, too, of how difficult it is for us in our culture to separate fact from fiction or reality from the screen. When we saw those towers come down, of course, it was almost like looking at a Hollywood disaster film. But it was when you were there, you realized that in addition to television, there is something called reality. When I was in seminary, Scripture, New Testament, the professor said, "Gentlemen, if you've read all the commentary on Scripture, I think you should read the Scripture. They shed a great deal of light on the commentary." And they remember all those celebrations for the millennium, the Eiffel Tower, the fireworks in London, the millennium tower, and all the wonderful celebrations you did. They're all common things. Then, of course, we're over. Now it's entering a new age, which we're going to have to adjust to a duller kind of culture, and we're going to have to concentrate on those things. So, the illumination of the change, and the crisis of culture has been mentioned. This summer, I did a country had a friendly relative, and she said, "Why don't you say it? He really has such a wonderful son." "No, he doesn't." Unbearably, as she said it, I said, "Don't say it." And the minute you say that, you know, something. The next week, we'll go to the worst way ever. So the minute you say that we're entering the time of peace, you know, the weapon that the prophets of all the world has to face is peace. Obviously, by the way, that's just what we're talking about. I'm saying that it's coming out from New York. The cultural difference between New York and here tonight. I know you've seen things on television, but the New York is the most solemn and green place. Imagine yesterday's worship goes to town. Today, the traffic is back, people are back, but there's no smile. Hear an eerie silence. The airline tickets are being honored by the train, which means the head station is absolutely packed. And yet you could hear a pin drop on the train station. Nobody knows what to say. It's just solid sobriety, solemnity. I did hear at the other end of the station suddenly a great round of applause, tremendous applause. President decided to detour from Penn Station. You know, and security for allowing me to do that, but I looked at fire along this road. There's a sense there. Anyway, I was abused for that. Right across from Penn Station, St. Francis Church, and finally, been able to secure my ticket. I went over there to pay my respects to the body. Judge, and right across from him was killed by the clergy, the chaplain, who
was killing animals. Right across the street is the London Fire Station, Fire Station 1. There's an montage where the firemen from that company were killed. And flowers there. So the whole city was caught destroyed. But tonight's the first night since Tuesday that I've been left. And it's a good thing. It's a sign of what a crisis we are in that we have to tell people that we have to laugh. I've been telling people not to cancel things. I remember once there was a student in London who was a terrorist spotter. People who had never gone to the theater in years went to the Wednesday matinee just to show you can't keep people down. Paul Judge was killed while just some months ago. A company, the paralyzed police officer, Stephen McDowell, was shot in quadriplegic. And he goes around the world and talks on his respirator. It's terrorism. And Father McDonald's wheelchair with his wife went to Northern Ireland to talk about peace and terrorism. And the priest who accompanied him was this Father Judge. I went into our parish office today, full of wonderful women. All of them were great about Irish Catholics. I carried away with the moment. They said, we should go home, what do we do? I said, no, remember what Lord Alexander said in the Blitz, we must be British. And congratulations, Father, of your parish, and God bless you. God's good to you. At least you're going to be in a safer place. Well, he was speaking to me on 43rd Street. My new parish is on 38th Street. That's how New Yorkers think. Mark Lincoln told me that what New York one block is as good as a mile. I do want to say these 10 minutes, five of which are already. And then we'll have questions. Well, because I have to catch a train, instead of questions, I think we should just have answers. But three things. When you're in a crisis, you're divided. Basically, all crises are summations of multiple crises. Our culture has had three crises unresolved. And we are now in a shock, which there's a going to decide whether everything just collapses or whether we do get serious resolve things. The reason we need a sharp treatment is because we become complacent, greedy, self-absorbed. You know that. One of the questions we've been asking these last couple of years, months, the bond rates, you would think our Greenspan is gone. And suddenly we realize that these are important matters, but they are far more. More important matters which we have failed to address. Number one, a crisis in our natural law, our concept of natural law. Is there a natural law? Secondly, a crisis in our sacramental consciousness, the church, the priesthood. Is the church real? Is it true? Is it one true thing? Or a priest who need priests. Priests bad. And we don't have the media that answers those questions. Thirdly, we need philosophical questions. Is there truth? John Paul II, I believe, Father wrote an encyclical saying the deepest crisis of our time is the breakdown of confidence in truth. But I think that what happened the other day was a sharp treatment for all those questions. Number one, natural law. founding fathers never said we have a right to happiness, we have a right to stewardship. God's grace guarantees that, and to pursue happiness by asking for God's grace. Fundamental natural law is the right to life, and our culture, as the Pope has told us, is a culture of death. I've had many people say, why do the Pope keep using this dismal language? They've stopped asking that question now. In the midst of all that chaos and all that death, I mean, in 1 hour, all those people dying, we know that there's such a thing as a right to life. Why are people running away from it? They didn't want to die. Why does somebody drop a jump from a 100-story window? And in the midst of all that confusion, I saw a young couple running for their lives, but pushing a baby carriage. And in the midst of all the screaming and chaos and sirens, in that carriage was a little baby fast asleep. He could have been in a nursery in Nebraska. And also the fact, was consoling that mother and father were pushing their body. Why would they do that? We live in a culture in which we should tell people they should run their own lives and maybe be really kind. Yes, they've done that millions of times. It's an abortion, that's what we do. It's what we need to be kind. This morning, at noon today, in St. Agnes Church, where I was, we had 9 or 10 masses a day. Even the bells were rung by the order of the president. I would say, as a small church, we had over 1,000 people coming. In the rain, they were out on the street, standing in the rain. And at one mass, and I went in to help with the communion, and I had to work my way through a group of young men. And something dawned on me. They were just watching this. They were all wearing yarmulkes. And afterwards, I went to the back of the church, and in the crowd there was a young woman, Australia, a baby. She told me that a friend of hers worked on one of the top floors of one of those towers, and he was about, he kissed his wife goodbye, and was going out to get the subway to go to his office, and she had a scream. She was starting into labor. So he rushed back and said, "Where I went that day, he went to the hospital. And the second tower collapsed, and the baby was coming out. The baby saved his life. The meaning of natural law, God gives him life. The young fellow had expressed in the form of my poem on Tuesday. He was shocked and said, just been married, and his wife worked on one of the top floors. He said, "Do you think she's safe?" He said, "But the only one of the people who thinks I turned around and looked at her. It's like hell." And at the same time, the end was, "Do you have any children?" It's an instinctive reaction. Why do you live to protect life? Well, I think that we are now going to be more serious in the way that we address that question. The second crisis is within our sacramental consciousness. The sacrament, at the end of the Book of Common Prayer, says it's an outward invisible sign of the inward spiritual grace. To a great degree, that consciousness. One writer said that talking about the Russian Revolution and comparing it to the French Reign of Terror, that What they had in common was a hatred of priests. Every divine god requires a hatred of the priests. And the priesthood, the Catholic Church, was a lawful, was a bad press. Much of it objective, much of it warranted, because a lot of Catholics, unfortunately, I have seen a lot of clergy in most countries, they are priesthood themselves, and you have a breakdown within sense of the ministry of the Church, the priesthood. The priesthood exists, the guides, and in the midst of the chaos on Tuesday, when that moment, when the father of Michael Judge was killed, only 15 minutes after having spoken to the mayor, and having the mayor said, pray for us, in the midst of all that carnage, which is indescribable, and what you see on television is very highly edited, I can tell you that. People jumping out of the building, one man landed on a fire and killed them, and people jump out of the country. Stories, they don't believe. And in the midst of all this, the firemen were able to take their chaplain, and it's by instinct, carried across the street to St. Peter's Church, St. Peter's Church, Barclay Street. All of them, by the way, covered with ash like Mount St. Helens, City Hall. Carried him in his empty church and placed him on the marble floor in front of the altar, covering the body, the sheet with his dad on it. And over the altar was a painting given by a Spanish king in the 18th century to the fledgling Catholic community in New York. That parish, by the way, from Barclay Street, extended all the way up to Buffalo. The painting of Christ bleeding on the cross. Before that painting, a young woman used to pray for guidance as to what she should do with her life, and her name was Elizabeth Ann Seton. And here, the body of this priest, and he had been badly mangled, and blood was falling down the altar steps. While I was filled with blood, and each one of them now was in my Lord for the same prayer for me to go back to the flames. And I thought, what can I do in all this? I'm useless, so you might be either. And one fireman gave me a helmet, a mask, and I was just dragged away, and they were really taking me, and I realized that we're all proud of this fire, and we're all watching them in confessions. I knew what they were going into. One after another. Father, I can't remember how long ago it was. I wanted to go to confession. And like Normandy, like Ypres, like every great battle in history, Agincourt, you name it, like a general absolution, and so many. Telling them that if they survived, I pray they would. If they got home, they go to their priest, confession. But there I was, that the one thing I could do was the one thing I was ordained to do, and was to do the last rites. Thirdly, a crisis of truth. Many people, whenever there's a birth, instinctively say, how can God live? This happened. The English theologian, Austin Ferris, said, what is an earthquake? And people say, what is God telling us of an earthquake? God is simply telling us the tectonic plates follow the laws of physics. What happened on Tuesday was not caused by any act of nature. It was caused by the devil. The devil is the prince of lies. And he's the prince of lies because he contradicts the truth. Our culture has lost heart in the truth. And if you don't believe there is truth, then you don't believe there are lies. Our nation, and you know very well, for many years began to say, we don't care who our leaders are, we don't care if they lie. All we want to know is their paycheck. Everybody lies. What does it matter if you lie? And somebody says, well, depends on what is is. You used to laugh and think it was clever. Well, the only reason we ask what is because we haven't listened to God say, I am the I am. What happened on Tuesday was the result of people who believed lies. They denied Christ as their Savior. They were following a fanatical form of religion, which was probably the earliest and certainly most successful Christian heresy. Any indifference is that doesn't believe in objective truth, so it doesn't matter what you believe, as long as you believe something that we know. That is the truth. So to Rutler Porter, at the end of Tuesday, so just who asked me, what do you think we can make of all this? I said, well, just look down there, pointing down to the carpet. And then look up there, and up north of the capital, and it was still the most beautiful blue sky in the Bay. It was the most gorgeous day. I said, there is hell, and there is heaven. There's a God, and there's a devil. Mm-hmm. I, God, now we know there's a God, and because God has rescued us, and also God.